In this video, we'll discuss how to treat pulmonary edema using antifoaming agents. Let's zoom on a tiny segment of the lung. Here you can see the alveoli, pulmonary capillaries, and pulmonary interstitium. Pulmonary edema is a condition caused by excess fluid in the lungs, including the airways like the alveoli, as well as in the interstitium, which is the tissue between the alveoli and the capillaries. This fluid collects in the alveoli, making it difficult to breathe. The diffusion rate of oxygen and carbon dioxide will decrease. The concentration of oxygen in the blood will decrease as well, a condition called hypoxemia. The concentration of carbon dioxide in the blood may increase too. Let's zoom on a small portion of one alveolus and the excess fluid in it. Here you can see the epithelium of the alveolus. When the molecules of oxygen pass through this layer of fluid, they can form foam. So you know how foam looks like, right? I'll show you a picture. Foam is a dispersed medium formed by trapping pockets of gas in a liquid or solid. In this case, we're trapping oxygen in the edema fluid. Epithelial cells also play a role in foam formation. Okay, so what do I mean by that? The presence of edema fluid in the alveoli of the lung hinders the diffusion of oxygen, upon which the cells of the respiratory epithelium normally depend for their own oxygenation. This sets up a vicious circle because the hypoxic epithelium becomes more permeable and so permits further passage of fluid. Because of that, the quantity of edema fluid and foam respectively will increase. We can break this vicious circle by using antifoaming agents. A typical antifoaming agent consists of oil, silicones, certain alcohols, but the majority of them cannot be used inside the human body. That's why we'll focus on ethanol and antifoamcillin as antifoaming agents used in pulmonary edema. Antifoaming agents eliminate existing foam and prevent the formation of further foam. Generally, these agents have surface active properties and are insoluble in the foaming medium, which is the edema fluid, by the way. Surface active agents, also called surfactants, are substances that, when added to a liquid, reduce the surface tension between two liquids, between a gas and a liquid, or between a liquid and a solid. In our case, between a gas and a liquid, of course. Antifoaming agents are surfactants too, but a different kind. Let me give you an example. Dish detergent is a surfactant. Surfactants are usually organic compounds that are amphiphilic, meaning they contain both hydrophobic groups and hydrophilic groups. Therefore, a surfactant contains both a water-soluble component and a water-insoluble component. By the way, the surface tension is the tendency of liquid surfaces at rest to shrink into the minimum surface area possible. Here you can see a droplet of water on a solid surface. Now, the same droplet, but in a schematic form. Water molecules are in blue. The inner molecules are pulled in all directions by other molecules, but surface molecules are pulled inward because there are no water molecules in the air to do the pulling. That's why the water droplet shrinks into the minimum surface area possible. Surface tension is a property of a liquid surface displayed by its acting as if it were a stretched elastic membrane. I mean, look at these mosquitoes on the water. It seems like they are on an elastic membrane, right? Surfactants reduce the surface tension of a liquid. Because of that, they make this imaginary elastic membrane less stretched. In other words, they reduce the work needed to create the foam and facilitate foam formation. Now think about this. When a dish detergent is added to water, it lowers the surface tension and a lot of bubbles will form. The detergent is a foaming agent because it facilitates the production of foam. Now the most important part. The detergent acts as a surfactant and reduces the surface tension of water, but it also causes air bubbles to become more stable. On the other hand, antifoaming agents are groups of surfactants that not only reduce the surface tension of water, but also destabilize the air bubbles and the foam. So you see, the difference between classic surfactants and antifoaming agents is very subtle. Okay, now let's zoom on this portion of the foam in our alveolus. The foam consists of a lot of bubbles, but I will show just three of them to save some space. A bubble is just a globule of air in a liquid. Each bubble is enclosed by a thin film or membrane called lamella. So lamella is the wall of the bubble. These lamellae are able to bind with each other, thus forming the foam. A lamella consists of a double layer of surfactant. I will draw just a couple of those amphiphilic molecules, but keep in mind that they are everywhere. Antifoaming agents like ethanol and antifoamcillin are less viscous than the foaming medium and are easily spreadable on foamy surfaces. I will represent their molecule with this purple dot. The antifoaming agent reaches the surface of the lamella. Then it enters the wall of the bubble. Once the antifoaming agent has entered the lamella, a lens is formed inside it. The lens begins to spread. The progressive spreading process increases the thickness of the lens, the shape of which is altered by movements in the foam. The resultant film is considerably less elastic than the surfactant film, which previously stabilized the lamella. This destabilization facilitates the rupture of the lamella. This causes rupture of the air bubbles and breakdown of surface foam. Now we'll look back into the alveolus. You can see how the surface foam gets broken down. The bubbles are agglomerated and the larger bubbles rise to the surface of the liquid more quickly and rupture. In this way, anti-foaming agents eliminate existing foam and prevent the formation of further foam. In clinical practice, we use vapors obtained by nebulization of water and ethanol. Specifically, we use 30 to 40% ethanol solution. Vapors are administered via a mask. From the lungs, alcohol can be absorbed in the bloodstream and go to the brain. So you better avoid using alcohol inhalation in little children. Another option for edema treatment is antifoamcillin aerosol inhalation. Antifoamcillin is in the form of a 10% alcoholic solution. We use 0.6 to 1 milliliter in inhalations. And don't forget oxygen therapy to prevent hypoxia in the body tissues and specifically in the epithelium of the alveoli, because the hypoxic epithelium becomes more permeable to fluid, which increases the quantity of edema and foam. Ethanol vapor inhalation can help patients with COVID-19, especially in early stages of SARS-CoV-2 infection. Acute respiratory distress syndrome, or ARDS for short, is a major complication of COVID-19, with subsequent formation of non-cardiogenic pulmonary edema. A lot of foam is produced in the alveoli. This worsens the oxygenation of the patients. Patients can even have bloody sputum formation. The doctors can use ethanol vapor inhalation because it reduces surface tension on the alveoli and markedly decreases foam formation with improvement of oxygenation. Ethanol can also act as a virucidal agent. SARS-CoV-2 is a lipophilic virus. Lipophilic viruses have a lipid envelope. When alcohol molecules bind with the fat membrane encasing the virus, the membrane is broken down, and the inside of the virus particle, including all of its critical components like proteins, becomes exposed to alcohol, which will denature proteins, and this is deadly for the virus. But since the concentration of ethanol in inhalation is pretty low, the virucidal effect is also low. For more details on this topic, watch my video about alcohols used as antiseptics and disinfectants. This concludes our lecture. Thank you for watching.